Your Steve Jones Show podcast will start shortly. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Brewers Outlet, your beverage supermarket on Reagan Street in Sunbury. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK, sponsored by Brewers Outlet. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
I'm going to put my feet up this weekend. Take some Brewers Outlet, make sure I'm all set to go. And I'm just going to watch games. It's not going to be the warmest weekend. But you have Maryland, Ohio State, you have Texas, Oklahoma, you got Alabama, Texas A&M. Pretty good weekend. Pretty good weekend. And then, of course, the NFL coming up. The Eagles have another boring matchup. Somebody, I don't know. Meanwhile, San Francisco and Dallas are playing like a big time matchup, like really good teams. You guys play anybody? No. Okay. Significant early wins? No. Just asking. Today's show brought to you by our good friends at Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street in Sunbury, the beverage supermarket, imports, domestics, microbrews, the best selection of beer anywhere. Wine coolers, water, soft drinks, snacks. They roast their peanuts fresh and hot every day. Six great flavors of slushies. Pickle bar, led by the barrels and the dills. Indeed, second to none. All at Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street in Sunbury. The beverage supermarket. And we're in the Sunbury Motors studio, Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf, online at sunburymotors.com. Big high school football night coming up tonight, which we previewed yesterday. Yes, Steve Williams will be filling in for Kevin Herr. Kevin is out of commission at the moment. Get him back next week. He'll be working with the chief tonight. It'll be the broadcast that we submit for awards at the end of the year, and then Kevin will accept it. Oh, did I miss something?
No. That spells Suda.
Hey, that's Steve Williams' voice, isn't it? No, not really. All right. So, I was just sending quick question. While we do that, we might as well get to your rant, which by a narrow margin. Oh, hold on a second. Rant? I vote for Matt's rants hands down. Randy from Danville. Wow. Randy says so. Randy's been a great listener, and he's called this show many times. If Randy's behind you, you got some juice, buddy.
You, sir, are my hero.
Wow, you got some. If Randy's behind you, then
that is by far the best endorsement I have received in this vote all week.
Yeah, because everybody else has been like, not Randy. Randy goes okay, you know, because yesterday was really disheartening for you.
It kind of was, yeah. I wasn't thrilled about that. I didn't take it as a full insult, but I wasn't totally thrilled either, you know? By the way, I also got another endorsement on Facebook. Mary Lynn says Matt voted Matt's rants. But Rob Cardillo on Twitter, or X, voted for the EAS test. So the EAS test did get one more vote, but I have two more endorsements since then. So I'm still in the lead, narrow lead.
Just so you know, we're just having fun with this, and that's what. And I sense with everybody that has either posted or voted, they're having fun with it too. So, and which I that's the way it should be, just to have fun with it. And that's what everybody's doing. Okay, let's see. Let's see. Let me get to questions. Greetings from the Bay Area, also known as ACC country. Stanford and Cal. Although I'm as traditional as the next Nittany Lion fan, I'm really excited to see the new matchups with the West Coast teams on our future schedules. I think it'll be really fun to visit all these new venues. Question for you about the State College Airport. I understand that the runway isn't long enough for larger planes to land, which forces teams to fly in and out of Harrisburg. If every Penn State team is going to be flying in and out of the West Coast and hosting four schools that would ideally fly into State College directly, why don't they build a larger runway? Seems like that would be a simple answer. Thanks, Jim. Jim, the airport here can take 737s. Okay, what it can't take is a 777. So it can't take a 777, but it can take 727s and 737s. And everybody flies in here. Nobody flies to Harrisburg and buses up. So, now there's a program out there that wants to take 500 people to the game. You're going to have to go to Harrisburg. But if you're talking about a flight that's going to have, how many seats are on the plane that we're on? 39 rows. So it's like 240, 234. But you got to knock out. See, 234, but you have to knock out first. How many rows? So I think it's like a 220-seat plane. So it's a 220-seat plane that we fly in and out of here for football. So, Jim, it's actually not the issue you think. They are looking to see if they can expand the runway here. The problem with expanding the runway is that the people who own the land, the land is ultra expensive. So we not only have to expand the runway, but they also have to widen the runway to take 777s. But they can take 727s and 737s, and they can do so with ease because I know I'm on them literally all the time. So people are not flying into Harrisburg. Every football team that comes in here flies into State College, which is the airport's 4 miles away from the stadium. But I think it's an excellent question because if you don't know, I always tell my class the same thing all the time. You don't know, ask. All right? No such thing as a dumb question. If you don't know, there are other people out there who probably don't know. Now, years ago, before they expanded the runway here, you had to go in and out of Harrisburg. I remember coming back from Alabama, going to Harrisburg, coming back from USC, going to Harrisburg. I mean, you know, that's the way it used to be. Not now. Now, bowl games are a little different. Bowl games, they do fly out of Harrisburg. Why? Because they're taking 777s. That's why. If you're taking a 777, you have to do that. If you're taking a 737, right, you'll fly directly in and out of State College. Okay, Jim? I hope that helps your question. Next, BTN coverage fake draw. This is from Eric. Shocked when people started saying it was a fake kneel down. I did want to clarify about BTN's coverage because obviously I didn't watch BTN's coverage. I was talking. Jake Butt was adamant it was a fake draw. Good for Jake. Rules analyst, not Dean Blandino, a different guy, went out of his way to ping into the broadcast to say it was a fake kneel down and should have been blown dead. Jake Butt was all over it and that he didn't agree with that, even though clearly the rules analyst had not ever seen Bo player watch the Penn State tape. There was over 2 minutes left, and they weren't in victory formation. Thanks for all you do, Eric, podcast listener. And again, that's the bottom line. The bottom line is you've got to. I'm glad Jake Butt was all over it, which is good. The rules analyst, I don't know. I couldn't tell you in a million years who the rules analyst was on the game. And is there anything else we have on the questions here? I think that's it. Okay. There you go. So now, after all the delaying tactics on my part, It's time now for your rant of the day. Your first of many rants, I believe.
Well, this is the only one I've got so far. So we'll see how the rest of the afternoon goes. So yesterday, during his weekly Wednesday press conference, or it was 2 days ago, I guess, Nick Sirianni was asked about, I guess, the third and 11 call when they ran the draw at the end of the game. They settled for the field goal, which allowed Washington to come back and tie the game the first time at 24. And as we all know, Brian Johnson is still doing the play calling, the new offensive coordinator for the Eagles. Well, Sirianni said on that play call, and this is the this is not the first time he's done this, that he overruled Brian Johnson. Brian Johnson was the one actually wanted to pass the ball in that situation, which would be the correct thing to do. And Sirianni overruled him and said, run the draw. Which, by the way, the Eagles nearly turned the ball over, too. Are you kidding me? I mean, not only is it bad to overrule a guy that you're supposedly trusting to be your offensive play caller, but then to go with that play when your offense is still humming and if you're trying to be as aggressive as you are, that was a pretty safe play call at that point in the game. I just don't understand it. I mean, I don't understand overruling your offensive coordinator. I know it's your offense, but you're still the guy handing the play calling to your offensive coordinator, let alone with that ridiculous play call. And this is not the first time it's happened. I don't know. Everything's going pretty well right now, and they're 4-0, but this spells trouble for me if you got a head coach trying to overrule and micromanage things, even though it really is his offense. That bothers me a lot. That really does. And that's kind of another strike for me against Nick Sirianni. And there's not many. I still think he's a good coach and good leader, but between some of the over-aggressiveness things that he does during the game and now this, trying to micromanage your offensive coordinator, I don't care if it's his first year or not. If you're trusting him to do the play calls, you let him do the play calls, especially when he made the right one in that time. I don't know. I don't like it. I don't like it.
What if he threw an interception?
Well, then that's it is what it is, I guess.
I'm just saying it's not completely risk-free.
I know, but I'm saying in that case, they should have passed the ball.
Like you say, on the draw play, he almost fumbled the ball. So not every play is risk-free.
Right.
I guess I'd rather
the interception happen because I wanted them to throw the ball to keep their foot on the gas instead of trying to play it safe when we still have plenty of time in the game.
Now, I just want to ask you this quick question. What title does Nick Sirianni have?
He is the head coach.
Oh. So Brian Johnson's not the head coach?
Correct.
So who's in charge?
It's Sirianni. I understand.
Okay. Well, guess what? He's the boss. I mean, you could disagree with the play call, but not with his right to change it. He's the head coach.
I just think it. I mean, I get it now. If there's something that you think is pretty egregious, I don't think it is in this case, then okay, I get that. Or if stuff's really not working and you're going through the course of the game, you want to see something change and you don't like it, you want to try something, okay, fine. I get that. I guess there's an exception to this. But in this case, I don't think there is. And I still think overall it sends the wrong message to your coaching staff.
1995, Penn State is playing Michigan State in East Lansing. And it's a great game. Wally Richardson's a quarterback. And they got down to the 2-yard line. And they had a play call to go to Mike Archie, which they worked on during the week. And Joe asked what the play call was. They told him about the pass play they wanted to run to Mike Archie. And he said, no, we're not running that play. He says, whatever play you call, it's got to be to Bobby Engram. And the coach is like, you know, hey, you're entitled to argue your point. They argued their point that, no, we've got this play. We've worked on it. We know. He says, no, no matter what play you call, even if it's that call, it's got to go to Bobby Engram. Well, he's the head coach, so they changed up. Wally Richardson threw a middle screen to Bobby Engram, and he got into the end zone for a touchdown, and Penn State won the game. But you do get a head coach every once in a while that looks out and says, look, in terms of managing the game, this is what I want to do, or this is who I want to go to. And if it failed, it would be on Joe if it failed. Okay? Because he's the head coach. Now, he would have had to take responsibility for it anyway. He wasn't going to sit there and go, oh, hey, it failed, and that's because my offensive coaches wanted to do this. Joe wouldn't do that. But in that case, it turned out on the overrule, and he, you know, remember talked to him about it a long time ago, and they said, you know, why so adamant about the fact that you wanted Engram? Because Mike was obviously a really good player, and he said, Steve, Bobby Engram was the best player in the field. I wanted the ball. I wanted to win or lose with the ball in the hands of my best player. That's what he said. And your best player is Jake Elliott. So,
get the lingerie on the deck. Call the janitor.
How many field goals you guys got this year? You guys got a lot of them.
Here's a stat for you. Jake Elliott and I believe Justin Tucker is the other kicker. They both have more points than the Giants' offense.
Oh, well, that's that I believe.
That's just a crazy stat. When the Giants' offense has 45 points, Jake Elliott has 48, and Tucker, I think he was the kicker, has 46.
Well, let me put it this way. The value of Saquon Barkley goes up with each one of these, doesn't it?
No question.
But, you know, you could disagree with Nick Sirianni. That's your prerogative. But he's the head coach. He's the one that has to ultimately be the one that has to make the final decision and everything. So his ability to overrule happens. It happens all the time. And you're a head coach for a reason. You're the one that's you're the CEO. You're the one that's in charge. You feel strongly about something, you don't keep your mouth shut about it. And it couldn't have been that wrong a decision. The Eagles won the game, right?
They did, yes.
I remember one year, Joe called six plays. You want to know what all six had in common? They were all touchdowns.
Well, I guess you can't argue with that now, can you?
No, it was in the 2000s. Can't remember which year it was. It could have been five. It might have been five or eight. It was one of the two. Right? God, I remember 1985, they're playing Alabama, and they ran a reverse to Michael Timpson, and then John Schaefer got hurt on the drive, and they brought in Matt Kisner, and they threw a touchdown pass to Brian Seiferling. And Joe was over there. The way it was related to me is he's now on reverses, Joe always referred to them as Sallies. Okay? He says, they're back in their own 20-yard line. He says, look, you got to run the Sally to Timpson. Like, okay. So they ran it, and he got 30 yards out to midfield. And then when Kisner came in the game, when Schaefer went down, Joe said, no. He said, throw a rollout pass to one of the tight ends. He said, they won't be expecting it. They'll think we're going to do something safe. So he threw in Cyril and caught one in for a touchdown. But you're against overruling.
In most cases, yes.
Well, I'm going to overrule you here. I'm going to take a break.
Oh, my almighty!
Back with more in a moment here on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Okay.
Want to work for a stable yet growing company? Got it. Want to work for a family-owned business with over 100 years' experience in taking care of customers and employees? Got it. Want to work for a leader in selling more cars and satisfying more customers? Got it. Who has all that? SMC Sunbury Motor Company is looking for technicians across all their departments. Whether you're an entry-level technician, an experienced technician, or someone looking for a career change, Sunbury Motors would love to hear from you. They're looking for technicians for their quick lane, car and light truck service, heavy truck service, body shop, and frame and alignment division. You can apply online at sunburymotors.com, in person at our North 4th Street location, or call Todd at 570-286-7746. Your new career of working on Fords, Kias, Hyundais, Western Star trucks, plus anything that fits in the door,
and some things that don't.
Join Sunbury Motors. Your new career is waiting for you.
Party time, game time, or just fun time. Doesn't matter what time it is, because it's Brewers Outlet time. The Beverage Supermarket has the area's largest beer selection. Imports, microbrews, ciders, and domestics. Pick from over 100 ice-cold 12-packs and dozens of 24-ounce singles. Soda, snacks, hot sauces, fresh roasted peanuts. Make it one-stop party shopping, and don't forget the pickle bar. So whatever you're celebrating or just doing it up, Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street, Sunbury, wants to see you. And thank you for your years of patronage.
This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK, sponsored by Brewers Outlet. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
And today's show brought to you by our great friends at Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street in Sunbury, the Beverage Supermarket, Imports, Domestics, Microbrews, the best selection of beer anywhere. Wine coolers, water, soft drinks, snacks. They roast their peanuts fresh and hot every day. Pickle bar, led by the outstanding barrels in the Dills. Indeed, second to none. All at Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street in Sunbury, the Beverage Supermarket. And we are in the Sunbury Motors Studio, Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com. Nick Sirriani keeps Brian Johnson away from making a huge mistake in your Met.
No, senor! No, senor! No, senor!
No. That wasn't it.
Not quite.
So if it's run back for a touchdown and you lose, you'd be killing the play call.
No, I'd be killing what happened. I mean, I have to see what happened on the Pacific play, but
why
I mean,
are you
I would
throwing the ball.
I would rather them go keep the foot on the gas than the other way around.
I see. All right. What game do you have tonight, by the way?
I also have Schick and Mifflinburg tonight.
Oh, okay, good.
With our good buddy Charlie Fisher.
Oh, my goodness. Really?
Yep. Charlie has been doing a lot of our games for us over on SECV8, and he is tremendous to work with, as, of course, I know you know.
He is one of the great guys I've ever met in doing this over the years.
Me too.
Please tell him I said hi.
I will.
Because I have nothing but great things to say about Charlie. Nothing. I mean, and not only that, on the golf course, he will tear you apart. But he'll do it with a smile. He'll do it with a smile.
That is good to know.
But he is smart, knows so much about the game.
Yes, he does.
He's got a great feel for it, so I'm not surprised he's doing well on the broadcast side. What a terrific, terrific guy. So, yeah, I'm glad to hear that.
Yeah, so me and him tonight on the TV side.
Very nice. Is there any way I can watch this, or?
Unfortunately, with SECV8, no. We don't have anything like on the internet or anything like that.
Okay, asking.
Unless you're a subscriber, then we have an app, but you have to be a subscriber.
Let me check this out here. Ooh, $250,000. That's a lot to subscribe.
Oh, my almighty!
Kind of makes me wonder where you're getting paid.
It's not bad. I can tell you that.
That's a big number.
For both sports beat and doing games, it's not bad.
I've been a guest on sports beat, as a matter of fact.
You have.
Yeah. People are shocked. Yes. I've been on sports beat. Yeah. So there you go. Okay, so the Big Ten yesterday, as we talked about this extensively, but the Big Ten put out their schedules, and I like very much what they did with it. Yeah, you have to be a conference, and that, to me, being in a conference means that you have to at least go out and do everything you can to play everybody. And I made this point before. All right? Made this point before. And you know, the SEC gets away with a lot of stuff. They really do. And they don't ever get called out on it. Okay, that's fine. Well, here's one for you. Texas A&M and Georgia, and you guys know I pointed this out how many times, right? Texas A&M is in its 13th season in the conference. Do you realize that they have played one time? And it was in Sanford Stadium. Georgia has never played a game at Texas A&M. How can you be in the same conference and never at least have one game in 13 years in a team stadium? Yeah. They've been in the same conference for 13 years, and Georgia has never played a game at Kyle Field. They've never played a game in Kyle Field ever. And you sit there, like, they're in the same conference. I realize they have eight conference games. I understand that. So you're automatically pegged in under the current divisional setup to play six teams in your conference. Everybody in the SEC has a crossover game. And, for example, the third Saturday in October is always with Tennessee. Now, they've been rotating those opponents. On the other side. So their crossovers have been since 2015, Alabama crossover, okay? At Ole Miss, Mississippi State, at LSU, hosted Texas A&M in 19. Then they played at Alabama in 20. Arkansas, Mississippi State, Ole Miss. The next year they do play at Texas A&M and then LSU. But when they play next year at Texas A&M, it will be the 14th season they've been in the conference. They've never played there. mean, that's insane. I believe Auburn's the team they cross over and play. I believe. But they get away with this. Why do they get away with it? I mean, you have 3 hours on game day. You couldn't spend a couple segments on why is this scheduled this way? Why do they only have 8 conference games? Why do they schedule in such a way where two schools go a decade and a half and never play each other in a stadium? So back to the Big Ten. And this 5-year schedule, you play everybody. Now, the strange part is you notice that Penn State finally plays at Nebraska in 2028. Right? That's another part that's been screwy. And I pointed this out before. When Penn State goes to Nebraska in Lincoln in 2028, it'll only be the third time since Nebraska came in that Penn State played in Lincoln. They played in 2012. This is when Nebraska was the designated crossover game. All right? And so the first two games or of the three were at Beaver Stadium. And, at one point, of course, we all know it's Iowa, Iowa, Iowa. Because at one point, when Dan Radakovich passed away, a lot of people went to Bad Rad's funeral. And Jack Ham went, they went to the wake viewing, and Jack Ham went. And ironically, Kirk Ferentz showed up, and he was there to pay tribute. And, of course, Kirk Ferentz, a Western PA guy. And they were just chit-chatting, and he says, let me ask you something. And this is Ferentz. He was being facetious, of course. He said, "We in the same division?" And Jack's laughing with him. He says, "Yeah, I know what you mean." And he says, "I don't get why we play each other all the time." And that's what happened. Penn State was playing Iowa all the time, all the time, all the time. The one break was 2022. But they've been playing them every single year. Okay, why? And I know why. This is their way of balancing the schedule. They try to take history, records, things like that, try to get, common across the board. It's why Ohio State played Wisconsin so many times and Michigan's played Nebraska so many times. I got that part. I know what they're trying to accomplish with it. But I didn't like what they were trying to accomplish with it. Now, this is different. I have said for years, if you're in the same conference, you should be playing everybody over a period of time. And it was not difficult before. You had two divisions, East, West. You play three teams home and away, 2-year span. Boom, boom, done. Then, years 3 and 4, you play the next three teams home and away. Ding, 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 ding. Get to year 5, and the one team you haven't played yet, okay, they become part of the rotation of 7, 1, and 2 that you play over a 2-year span. So guess what? Over that 5-year span, you end up playing everybody, and over a 6-year span, you end up playing everybody home and away. No offense, Not difficult. And the Big Ten didn't do that. It mixed them in here and there, but Penn State kept playing Iowa every year. It's like, no, rotate it around. Well, these schedules, they've done that. I like it. Yeah, there are some schools where Penn State plays twice. Nebraska's one of them. Most of them, they're playing three times. Okay. And I think that's the right way to do it. And again, it's easy to be negative about negative on the NCAA all the time. It's easy to be negative on the Big Ten all the time. No, if you're going to do a show like this, show the responsibility that when you think they're doing something right, and every time the NCAA has done something right, rare moments, but I've said, look, they did it right. Same thing with the Big Ten. When they've done something right, I point out right away, I go, you know what? I like what they did. They did it right. And with having 18 schools, it was difficult to do. I mean, it's difficult to do. And Auburn, Georgia, by the way, is Auburn is the designated crossover rival for Georgia in the SEC. Which they just played, by the way. It's a good game. But again, when they do it right, or like something, I'd say, you know, I like how they did that. I give credit where credit's due. I thought the Big Ten did not just a good job, I thought the Big Ten did a great job doing this. Yeah, Michigan's another team Penn State only plays twice in this five-year span. Nebraska, they play twice. Michigan, they play twice. And I'd have the schedules in front of me to see. Most of them, they play three times. And then also, in looking at the schedule, Penn State has one West Coast road trip in each of the 5 years. They go twice to USC, 24, 28. Then they go to UCLA in 25. They got to go to Oregon and Washington the other 2 years. So each year has one West Coast road trip to it. And again, that goes back to Jim's question about the travel part of it. Again, they can take 737s and 727s and McDonnell Douglas 80s can all get in here. Not an issue. It's a 777. You can't. Most teams don't fly a 777. So everybody does fly in here, Jim. Everybody does. Okay, we'll take a break. We'll come back. More in a moment. Matt cooling his Jets. When you're with Charlie, do you rant, or is it just me?
It's usually just you most of the time.
Is it something I'm doing?
No, it's just this platform, and it's just very cathartic. You just have that way about you. I'm sure Charlie does too, but it's just never come up.
We'll come back with more in a moment on News Radio 1070 WKOK, brought to you by Brewers Outlet. All right, so Charlie Fisher is not going to work with you. He's actually going to be on the Bucknell game tomorrow. Holy Cross Bucknell.
That's right. He also did the game last week, too, with Doug.
Charlie's the type of analyst who will, when the broadcast is over with, you're going to feel like you've learned more about not only the game you're watching, but the game of football.
Absolutely.
So, yes. All right. Suit is out of commission right now. Spending all the residuals, by the way, because they were looking around that commercial we just aired for Babbel. They're trying to figure out, what should we call this app? And then they heard a Shikellamy broadcast. How about Babbel? Oh,
S-U-I-T. That spells suit-a.
Hope he feels better. Hope he feels better. He's not feeling well. Said something about, like, it seems to really hit him between 1 and 3. What? I don't know what that means.
Get the lingerie on the deck. Call the janitor.
So what do you want to watch tomorrow? Do you want to watch Maryland, Ohio State, or do you want to watch Texas, Oklahoma?
Oh, Texas, Oklahoma by a mile. Ohio State's going to beat the snot out of Maryland.
I'll probably watch the Ohio State-Maryland game because Penn State plays both. So I'll probably take a long, long look at that, but I will definitely be flipping over to Texas, Oklahoma. Last year, Texas blew out Oklahoma. I think it was 49-0, wasn't it? Something like that.
I believe that is correct, yeah.
I think it was the first time in 25 years neither team had been ranked. Now, this year it's a little bit different. But, yeah, it's a big stakes weekend in big Tex country. All right, you've got Oklahoma and Texas. Both are undefeated. And then you've got... Is this the weekend Alabama's playing Texas A&M? Yeah. 3:30.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then Niners Cowboys.
That game's at Levi's Stadium, though.
Correct.
Yeah, these two games are in Texas. Yeah, Niners Cowboys are big. It's amazing what happens when you play, you know, like good teams play each other. Who do you guys play this weekend?
At the Rams. Not an easy game, but I think it's a W.
When are you going to play an NFL team?
Oh, well, that'll be coming up soon. Don't you worry.
Well, this is where the losses start to pile up?